This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Srinivasan. I'm joined here by Sebastian Copeland, who is one of a very few men on Earth, men and women on Earth, that have ever made it to the North Pole. Thanks for being here.
Thank you very much. Yeah, in fact, there are some women who did reach the North Pole. It's important to mention them.
So you went on foot for more than 400 miles, you and one partner.
That's correct.
And you guys, it took you, what, 5 weeks?
It took us a little over 5 weeks, yeah.
And one of the things that you try to make a point into this in this documentary called Into the Cold, which will be available soon, is that there might not be a way for someone to replicate what you did because the ice is literally melting that fast.
That's correct. Yeah, there may not be a pole to reach on foot. This is a commemorative 100-year anniversary, and it's absolutely true that within the next decade, perhaps two decades, it will no longer be possible for people to reach the North Pole in the way that Perry did 100 years ago in 1909.
And so this is primarily because that the temperatures are warming around it enough and that there's enough ice melt? Is that why?
It really is primarily has to do with how quick the temperature shifts from very cold in the winter period or in the spring to summer. I mean, basically the spring season is accelerated and the melt period comes in much earlier than it used to. So it's still very, very cold in the winter, but the period between the very cold period of the early onset in winter and the dark days of the polar time, until the moment where the ice breaks up around the polar region, this happens really quickly. So there's just a lot of motion in on the ice.
Now, what you point out in the film is that not all ice is the same, and that not all of the North Pole is the same. Although we might just think it's just one big chunk of ice, you're saying that there's different kinds of ice and that this sort of seasonal shift that's happening faster is changing the composition.
That's correct. There's multi-year ice, which is ice that's been there generally it's called multi-year ice when it's been there for 10 years or more, and then there's anything in between. The North Pole, contrary to the South Pole, of course, and many people don't realize that, is essentially just across the frozen ocean. It is a crust that varies in depth between 6 to 8 feet or so, and actually is shrinking up. And literally, the multi-year ice, which used to account for about 80% of the Arctic 20 years ago, represents only 3% of the Arctic today.
Let's talk a little bit about just the physical challenge of this. How many hours a day were you pulling this sled, which is what, almost 200, 250 pounds?
This one was a little over 200, yeah.
You're pulling a 200-pound sled on cross-country skis or snowshoes day after day after day. It's just you and this one other guy.
That's right.
There's nobody around for thousands of miles.
Yeah. Huh.
And what does that do to you, I guess, physically and psychologically? Did you lose a lot of weight during this? I mean,
yeah, you certainly lose a lot of weight. For sure, you're burning about 11,000 to 12,000 calories a day. You can only really eat between 5,000 and 7,000. It takes a lot of work to eat more than 5,000 calories, and so you're shedding weight. I lost a little over 22 pounds. I think my partner lost 23, and I lost 22, if I recall.
Wow.
So you definitely lose weight. The time of travel has to do with generally two factors. One, temperature.
Right.
When it's colder than 40 degrees below, 40 and 50, and then colder than that, your physical resistance to cold and your ability to be exposed to the element is greatly reduced. So that generally gives you yields about a 6, sometimes 7 hour day at the very most in 50 below. But in 30, 33 or 35 below, you can really pull this up to 15 hours a day. So
well, that's except when you're going across these massive boulder fields. That was another kind of thing that I didn't realize. It's not all flat. I mean, there are significant chunks of ice that are constantly in flux.
That's true. I mean, I've got kids who come up to me and say, can you just ice skate all the way to the North Pole? And the reality, of course, you can't. It's very, very uneven terrain. But what happens is the tides and the winds and the currents are creating these massive shifts around the polar region and takes these, these plates of ice and either pushes them together where they crumble and create what's called pressure ridges, or quite the contrary, they just separate and open up into what's called open leads, which are freshwater leads, basically, that are open until they freeze over, which sometimes can take just a few hours.
And you had to cross a couple of those, and it was pretty harrowing.
You always have to cross leads, and it's always harrowing. The leads are the thing that that really define the North Pole as opposed to any other region in the world. Those leads are always give you a bit of a chill, no pun intended, when you come next to them, because they sometimes force you to just jump in the water with a special suit and swim across, and another time you just fall in, not by choice but by accident. That's happened to me once.
You were mentioning, I think the sun doesn't rise or set more than what, 15 or 20 degrees when you were going there?
That's correct. But when you in the very sort of the last few degrees of the northern hemisphere, by about March 3rd, the sun doesn't set anymore. So it just circles at the sort of very low degree around the horizon, and progressively as the summer season approaches, it rises a little bit more, but always sort of circling around the horizon.
So there's a moment where you literally are on the North Pole itself, and you kind of do a little circle, and you've essentially walked around all the time zones on Earth. Yeah. Now, I mean, we kind of watched that with you at the time, but now looking back on it, what was that moment like?
Well, it's really amazing to reach your destination when you face the odds and the challenges, and the North Pole has this symbolic attachment. You know, we sort of want to put our own flag into the North Pole, which is, you know, the North Pole, because it's a crust of ice that's constantly in motion. That North Pole for that one moment will not be the same few moments later. So you've got the North Pole, unlike the South Pole, which is, you know, just about static. It moves very, 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 very slowly. But pretty much everyone can touch the ball, and that's the South Pole. But then the North Pole, it's like, it doesn't look like anything. Sometimes the North Pole is an open lead. Some people can never actually get to the North Pole because it's wet, you know, and they just sit there and go, it's over there, but they can't reach it.
Sebastian Copeland, congratulations on the expedition, and thanks for the documentary. You can see a link to the documentary on our website. This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Srinivasan with Sebastian Copeland. Stay with us.